And so, we reach the home stretch, the part of the story most Australians are familiar with. With the chaos of the 70s coming to a close, Australia had settled down to the two-party system, with the Labour Party on the left and the Liberal NC coalition on the right. The next 32 years would be a period I like to call the Great Stability, as every Prime Minister would see a term longer than 3 years. This stability would also be brought about by the introduction of a third party, who would hold the balance of power and keep those bastards honest. However, all good times come to an end, and as the 2000s come to a close, we will see how Australia goes through 5 Prime Ministers in 5 years, combined with the rise of fringe parties and the deterioration of public trust in the government. So let's begin the last leg of the journey through Australian political history with the election of 1977. Shout out to my cousin James Finlay for that brand new opening. You can check out his channel in the description below. Despite the chaos caused by the 1975 constitutional crisis and subsequent election, things began to settle down in Australia. With the energy crisis becoming a distant memory, the now elected Prime Minister Malcolm Fraser began to cut back on the high spending of the previous Labor government in order to get inflation under control. This involved cuts to the public sector, the arts, as well as healthcare. However, he would keep Labor's Medibank insurance scheme. Despite being from the Liberals' conservative faction, Fraser would practice Keynesian economics and would run budget deficits, much to the dismay of several of his supporters, including a young John Howard. Fraser would keep his critics in check by ruling with a strict party discipline, the likes which had not been seen since the Menzies era. Fraser was able to rule in such a manner due to the Liberals holding a majority outright. NCP leader Doug Anthony found despite holding the position of Deputy Prime Minister, his sway in the government was much smaller than it had been back in 1972 before the coalition lost to Labour. On the social side of policies, Fraser would ratify the Aboriginal Lands Right Act into law, giving large areas of the Northern Territory over to Indigenous communities. Fraser would also continue the nation's boycott of the apartheid run in South Africa, preventing their sports teams playing in Australia. He would also oversee a large number of non-white immigrants arriving in Australia, including both Vietnamese and Lebanese. To account for the large number of non-white immigrants arriving in Australia, Fraser would create the Australian Institute of Multicultural Affairs to help settle these immigrants into Australia, which included the establishment of the Special Broadcasting Service, or SBS. As the election came around, things seemed to be going smoothly. The biggest mishap to befall for the Fraser government would come in late 1977, when it was revealed that Treasurer and Deputy Liberal Leader Philip Lynch was using his family trust to avoid paying taxes. This forced him to resign as Treasurer and be replaced by Howard, who would continue to hold the position even after Lynch was cleared of any wrongdoing. Meanwhile, on the other side of Parliament, Gough Whitlam continued to lead the Labour Party despite its crushing defeat in 1975. Whitlam had initially planned to give the role of Labour Leader over to his former Treasurer Bill Hayden, who at the time was the only Labour member from Queensland. However, Hayden declined, not filling up for the task. Hayden would later change his mind. However, by this point, Whitlam had decided to remain as Labour leader into the next election. Despite no longer being in government, Whitlam was still being haunted by the aftermath of his time as Prime Minister. In 1976, another finance controversy would be exposed when it was reported that Labour had sought financing from another Arab source, this time from Iraq. This deal too never ended up happening, but it would again hurt Whitlam's image. Another controversy would occur when an earthquake hit China at the same time Whitlam was visiting. Despite not being anywhere near the epicenter, the Age newspaper would publish a cartoon depicting Whitlam and his wife in bed, with his wife quoting, "Did the earth move for you too, dear?" This cartoon would receive mass outrage from the Labour members, as well as Whitlam himself. Labour would not be the only party Fraser would have to deal with this time around. In March 1977, Victorian Liberal MP Don Chipp would resign from the party, accusing both sides of Parliament as being too partisan-focused. Meanwhile, at the same time, the Australian Party and the New Liberal Movement, two small minor parties, would join forces to create the Australian Democrats. Chipp would be invited to join this party and would immediately become its leader. Despite the election not being due until the end of 1978, Fraser would call the election early and set the date for the 10th of December 1977. Fraser claimed this was being done to make sure the Senate and House election calendars would fall in sync. However, others believed it was due to a pessimistic economic outlook for 1978, which would hurt the coalition's election promises. So Fraser, still with the weight of Lynch's scandal, would face off with Whitlam for a second time. As the campaign developed, Labour began to gain momentum with what they saw as a return to form for Whitlam, going back to his talking points which had won him government back in 1972. Meanwhile, the Democrats started to draw large amounts of supporters, the likes that had not been seen for an independent third party since the DLP collapsed in 1974. This election would also surprisingly see a reduction in seats, down to 124. This was done so the lower house would not hold more than twice the number of Senate seats, in the case another joint sitting was held. And the winner was Don Dunstan and Labour with 27 seats, a gain of 4. Wait. Oh, sorry, wrong election. Despite Whitlam's supposed return to form, Fraser would soundly win 86 seats, with a loss of 5 seats, 3 of which were due to the reduction in the total number of seats. This would yet again mean the Liberals held a majority outright, although to this date this would be the last time the party would achieve such. Meanwhile, Whitlam, who'd only picked up 2 seats in Queensland to hold 38, would resign shortly after this election. The man who had witnessed the demise of 4 Liberal leaders and had revolutionised the Labour Party would see this election as the final nail in the coffin of his leadership, and thus would step down as Labour leader after leading the party for just shy of 11 years, the longest for any Labour leader. Despite not winning any seats in the lower house, the Democrats would win 2 seats in the Senate, with Don Chipp in Victoria and Colin Marson in New South Wales. They would also score roughly 10% of the vote in both houses. Despite this, the coalition would still hold its Senate majority from 1975, and thus would govern Australia through the rest of the 70s. Despite the election being quite uneventful, this election would also see 4 referendums and the conduction of a plebiscite on the national anthem. 3 of these referendums would be carried, which included a change to Senate vacancies to prevent a repeat of Bjelke-Petersen's stunt in 1975. To date, this is the last time an Australian federal referendum has been successful. Well, with that election over, we move into another decade as I come back next time for the election of 1980.